who connect precisely the first step of the Exodus, which is in the coast of Havana or in the country, and reconnect it in Guantanamo Bay, which is very interesting. But we had an exhibition. We were invited at Art America 2012, and we met there documentary guys, Mario Marcinski, who is a professor at Boston University and lives there. He's a Polish descendant person, very clever and very well known in this. I don't know if you know it. And this was maybe his first idea, because at this time we had a little exhibition of 30 photos, because we were invited in the opening of an event that was Arte Foto, or I don't know, in this context of Art America. And he told me, if you find five of this guy, I make you a movie. So I'm about to call him, because I have nine at this time. But he brought to me this idea, which is so interesting. Is the way to reconnect. How about the people on your photograph 20 years before, and how about their life and today? What have been up there? So this is maybe because of the idea of this man, which is very clever, is in the base of this exhibition that we have, that we're going to inaugurate next week in Centro Cultural Español.
Thank you. Polly, do you want to add
something? I just wanted to say, anybody who wants to do more reading on this subject, the librarian is coming out in me here. At the Duke University website, I've kept a bibliography on the Cuban rafter phenomenon. So here are the films and videos that I know of. And one of those people from the film Balseros, I met at the Greyhound bus station in Miami in 2004. The man who has an accident and is crippled and was in the church in Houston. Yeah. He actually lives in Miami. Yeah. And I met him here and talked to him. He had no idea that the film had ever been produced. No one ever, the people who were interviewed in that film, they were never told that the movie actually was made. So he was very surprised when I walked up to him and met him. But anyway, you can, if you want to, you can, go to this bibliography, and it covers books, journal articles, whatever, and read more. I wanted to say, in response to some of the other questions, why there's no protest. I think one of the reasons why there's no protest is because publicly this has been cast as something that is criminal and needs to be handled in a military way. And the human element has been taken out of it, so that people don't realize that it continues to be this, what it always was, as well as people don't know how to come to grips with the human smuggling aspect of it and the violence related to that. It's very frightening. Those people in Mexico who have been doing very good reporting on this, they literally have had to put layers of cement over their newspaper building. They've had to close up all of the windows, and if you see the photographs of it, it's covered in bullet holes. So there's a very high cost of covering what's happening with that portion of it now, and the government would like us to forget about the more independent people. Then I think in answer to your question, what came out of it that wasn't just a blip was those 20,000 visas a year guaranteed. And it's produced the largest exodus, largest wave of people coming of any wave of the Cuban exile. So that was something very large and very permanent.
I'd like to say something to you that asked the question about why there hasn't been more activism, if you may, on this side of the waters. To begin with, the people that left Cuba left very frustrated. they risked their lives to change their lives. Once they got here, they did change their lives. They left, like they say, para resolver. Once they got here, they had already solved. And the ones that are here for the mayor part, they don't care. And that's the truth.
I think that it's not so easy to explain the behavior. First, have passed 20 years. We are in a new millennium. We are now back in 1994. We are in 2014. The situation in Cuba has changed. The situation in Miami has changed. The Cubans in Cuba have changed. The Cubans in Miami have changed. You know, in 20 years, many Cubans that came, they say when they were in the 40s, or in the 50s, in the early 60s, they have passed away. And it's a new generation, people that seem different. And the way, and the same way the people that are coming now, they feel different. It's not because it's good or it's bad. They are different. There is, as Holly was pointing out, in the last 20 years, almost 750,000 new Cubans have come to the States. And that make a change. I remember back in making little history, back in 1982, under Reagan administration, a Cuban came inside a ship, a stowaway, and he was deported to Cuba. And I remember that, the people that are here will remember, that was the first time that a Cuban went in rioting a street. And we had confrontation with the police, and many people went to jail, because we complain about that single deportation. That was the last time that we have a demonstration against deportation. That is a fact. So after that, when the Mariel people were starting to be deported, they didn't give a shit, they deported. We didn't took conscience that they were going to be deported to the same place where they have escaped. And let me say something more. We have been mentioned the policy of wet feet and dry feet. That policy first do not exist as a consequence of the crisis of 1994. This policy was implemented in April of 1999 and was implemented because the United States government in the agreement of 1995 they didn't have an agreement for the deportation of the people that tried to come illegally and were here. And then the Supreme Court of the United States made a rule where the rule was that immigration cannot detain indefinitely an illegally immigrant. Then if the United States didn't have the choice to deport back those Cubans that were touching land back to Cuba because there was an agreement with the United States of America. And at the same time, they cannot hold these people in prison indefinitely. The only choice was to release these people to the street. And that is the only reason that why the dry food, wet food exists.
Thank you. Let's go for a second round of questions, and there was a hand.
Well, actually, my question is just a concern, okay? Because Mr. De Castillo mentioned the fact that in Cuba has been changed. What kind of change? It's the same dictatorship that's been there in power for the past 55 years. Raptors are still coming out of Cuba. Not only coming to the States, but going into Mexico or into Honduras, into Grand Cayman, and there are still people going into jails because they do not agree with the system. And I'm concerned when there's some kind of a misinformation given as to there had been a change in Cuba. I haven't seen that change. I haven't seen that in more than 55 years, at least. That's my opinion.
Okay. Any other questions or from the audience? Igor, would you like to respond?
No.
Okay, if there's no more questions, thank you again for everyone, and thank you for the time. Okay.